Ember Reichgott Junge, author of Zero Chance of Passage. Thanks for joining us on Choice Media. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
And so, first of all, congratulations. Your book was just honored as the 2013 Grand Prize winner for self-published book by
Writer's Digest.
Writer's Digest. And so, yeah, that's why you're in New York right now because of that. And so, congratulations.
Thank you so much. And I am attending their national conference here, and we're going to be talking tomorrow about self-publishing. And I'm very, very honored. Thank you.
Now, we've chatted before about this, but Zero Chance of Passage is what someone told you when back in the, what I like to say, what historians call the 90s, you had this idea for charter schools, and people said, you know, Ember, you might as well just forget about this stupid idea. No one's going to vote for it. It has zero chance of passage.
That's pretty much it. Actually, the idea was brought to us by a group of civic leaders in Minnesota, leaders in education and business and community. But to your story, my House counterpart, Representative Kelso, was given the bill. I gave her the bill, and I said, Becky, I know you're a supporter. Please take it in the House. And when she was asked many years later, when she was interviewed for this book, well, what did you think when Ember gave you that bill? She responded, to my enormous surprise, that she had zero confidence it would pass. So that was the House champion.
And that was years later. I thought it was contemporaneous at the time. All right. So it's not like a case of someone, you know, rejecting the Beatles, only to find out later that the Beatles, you know, were fairly popular.
But I didn't until 20 years later. So I didn't realize how difficult she thought it was going to be.
All right. Well, and so let's talk about, I guess, some of the misconceptions about charter schools. People say that this is a scheme to line the pockets of billionaires, right? Right? But who privatize the school system and let fat cats, you know, get even richer, just to starve the children from resources, right?
Well, no. Let's start with that. No.
Yeah. All right.
I've been to 23 states in the last 18 months, and I continue to be surprised about what I hear about chartering and all the various myths, and you've hit on some of them. First of all, a lot of people do believe that charter schools receive more money than district public schools. Charter public schools, of course, receive on average only 70% of the funding of district public schools. So that's a myth. But secondly, and most commonly, people will say, well, why are you taking the money from our district schools down the block?
Right.
And what they don't really understand is that the money follows the student,
right,
and that every student deserves an effective education. And, you know, it's really who spends the money. Because if you're the superintendent of, let's say, the Minneapolis School District, you get to choose if the students in this neighborhood get to have more of their share of the money and the students here less. But with chartering, the students in the charter school are guaranteed the amount they are owed under the state law.
And by the way, we were looking at some videos from you, for speaking of the 1990s, I was intrigued by a 1997 C-SPAN video of you appearing with President Clinton, who was president at the time, Vice President Al Gore.
Mr. President, you know State Senator Ember Reichgott Junge in Minnesota. She has been instrumental in passing legislation that has given families much greater choice in their public schools. Ember?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Vice President and Mr. President. It's a tremendous honor to be here today. Charter schools have captured the enthusiasm and new ideas and energy of parents and families around the country. And Mr. President, with your leadership, that of Vice President Gore and Secretary Riley, with your help in startup funding for charter schools, I'm so pleased that this fall there will be 500 charter schools operating throughout the nation.
You pointed out that charter schools are, it's not a party thing. Plenty of Democrats and Republicans support charter schools. And in that very meeting, President Clinton praised charter schools.
Giving parents all these choices and all this power, the important thing, almost none of them will choose to go outside their neighborhood or assigned district. But knowing that they have the ability to do it changes the attitude of everybody in all the districts.
President Obama has been a Democrat supportive of the charter school movement. So do you feel that this party thing is, I don't know, is it going away? Is it when you have a Democrat versus Democrat, like in New York State, the governor versus New York City, the mayor, both Democrats on both sides of charters, arguably, is this allegation that Democrats aren't for charters going away?
Well, first of all, let's just start here. In the 2013 Cap and Gallup poll, 70% of the American public supports chartering. Now, I ask you, what other issue in this country does 70% of the American public support today?
Right.
Now, every single presidential candidate of all parties since Bill Clinton championed it has supported chartering. So when you look at what chartering is, public school choice, opportunities, effective education for all, you get a very high support level from America. What's happened is that in some cases the opponents have shaped the message differently, and sometimes in different states it comes out differently. And they don't see it as bipartisan. They don't see it that way. They think it came from the right or the left. It actually came from the middle of the political spectrum. It was bipartisan and came from civic leaders outside of the system.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let me just read to you something I printed out today. This is called School Privatization and the Charter School Scam.
Oh.
And I just highlighted a couple lines. The charter school racket is the perfect Trojan horse for corporate domination of the classroom at public expense, opening up a new wholly subsidized educational market valued at hundreds of billions of dollars a year in which the public pays and private parties profit.
Oh, wow.
This word profit, they leave out the fact that first of all, the great majority of charter schools are all nonprofit anyway, right? Mm-hmm. And yet they'll use this word profit all the time.
One of the things I've found as I've traveled is that one third of America still believes that charter public schools are private schools, and that's where we start from. Then if you add to that that there are management companies that are sometimes asked by the charter schools to manage the schools, then they get that all mixed up. But you know, there are for-profit management companies and there are non-profit management companies. But all of them have a non-profit board of directors that chooses to hire one or the other in order to have the best results for their students. There is no owning a school. Nobody is pocketing any profits. They're paying someone to do the administrative function so they can do their side of the mission better. I do want to say that there are some times when some people do abuse this process, and unless we have strong governing boards that do their job to make sure that the management company is doing its work, or strong authorizers to make sure that the board is held accountable, then we won't be successful. So those two things are critical for the system
to be true in any human endeavor, right? In any system you design, there are people, individuals, who may take advantage of a situation or may be corrupt or may cheat, etc. That's certainly true in district schools, too.
It happens everywhere. Right. Everywhere. We have to be sure to hold the charter schools accountable because, as you know, that's the whole charter school bargain. That's how the origins occurred back in 1991. And that is, you teachers and parents get this opportunity, this independence, this autonomy in return for committing to performance outcomes in the charter, right? You swapped charter, you swapped regulation for results, and you are held accountable to those results or the school may be closed. That is what's different than in district public schools.
One of the news stories we put on our Choice Media Newswire this week was about Ohio, and NACSA, the National Association of Charter School Authorizers, called Ohio the wild, wild west of chartering, which they intended as a pejorative, by the way. I'm from, grew up in Texas, so to me, wild, wild west is not a pejorative, but nevertheless, they meant that in a negative way because there are 69 different agencies in Ohio that can charter. And so I just wanted to know your thoughts on the case where maybe you have a D-rated charter school, which is, if it didn't exist, those kids would be at an F-rated district school. And so do you close down a mediocre or sort of underperforming charter school if the alternative in the district is much worse?
Well, I think that is a decision for the authorizer and the board, and they need to judge what alternatives are available. But you bring up a whole lot of issues there. First of all, I want to talk about those authorizers. In Minnesota, we have multiple authorizers, too. When the charter school law first passed, it was severely compromised, and I was devastated because the only authorizer allowed was the local school boards. That was it.
Many states, that's still the case.
I know, but you know what? That gatekeeper was pretty closed, okay? And the first 7 of 9 applications in Minnesota never made it through the gate because the school board said no.
And one asking of the McDonald's to authorize a Burger King mini
state. Exactly. The state called it the fox guarding the chickens, right? So then we came back, amended the law, and had a state board, and then ultimately authorized more authorizers, including nonprofits that were greater than $3 million and higher education institutions. Because of that, we've had a robust charter sector, and our law is rated number one in the nation. However, 4 years ago, we had a little bit of the wild, wild west in Minnesota, and we had to clamp down on those authorizers because they weren't always doing their job. And so the legislature came in and said, you've got to be doing more than just ignoring the minutes and taking your money and not doing anything. You have to be holding the board accountable. And so we changed the law, and now it's working much better. Ohio needs to do the same thing. As I said earlier, this doesn't work unless you've got well-trained authorizers and well-trained governing boards.
But what about the parents' role in this? And if parents say, no, we like this school, and you say, well, I'm sorry, it doesn't meet our authorizer standards, I guess it is a valid question to say, do you consider the parents kind of gullible pawns who need to be protected from their own bad decision-making? Or do you trust them to make a decision? And I'm not talking about if a school is stealing or if a school is doing something blatantly illegal, but just in the case of a curriculum question or a subjective assessment of quality, shouldn't you trust parents?
Well, here's what I feel. There are so many different ways to judge whether they're achieving, and testing is not the sole way to do that. Unfortunately, we see a lot of schools, and they say if you don't make this, you know, this on the test, you've got to close or something like that. I think we need multiple measures of their growth. I think we need to recognize that they grow over 2 to 3 years. They might not be at standard, but if they've made 3 years of growth, that should count. And if you see all those positive indicators, oh, that school is there. We have one that should stay open. We have a school in Minnesota called the High School for Recording Arts. Probably doesn't meet all the state standards, but these are young people who are extremely talented, are producing records and everything else. They don't survive in a normal high school, but this is giving them a whole new life, and their passion is there, and they're going on and helping other kids. So no, I wouldn't want to close down that school. So we have to look at multiple measures of success.
To the chagrin of many, Common Core has been sucking the oxygen out of much of the education reform and school choice debate. And I just wondered what your thoughts are on it. Louisiana's having a huge dust up right now with lawsuits, both directions, from for and against Common Core. The governor becoming anti-Common Core after he had been supportive. What are your thoughts on Common Core?
I'm not an educator. I'm an attorney. So I don't know the ins and outs of it, but I will say this. I find that as I travel around the country that the debate around Common Core sometimes gets all mixed up with the debate on chartering. And conservatives particularly will be saying things that they are against Common Core and therefore charters are bad. And that's a problem because they're very separate. And, you know, chartering is about a system. It's a permission for a school to operate in a certain way. It has nothing to do with Common Core. So that's my biggest concern about it.
Teacher tenure has been in the news lately. We had the Vergara decision in California where plaintiffs sued on behalf of students this time. Usually the suits over teacher tenure had been on behalf of teachers as plaintiffs. This time students were plaintiffs and the students won. And so now there's a suit in New York to do the same kind of thing, to challenge teacher tenure. Campbell Brown just this week was on the Colbert Report talking about this. And for many, this is a big advantage of charters, that they're not beholden to the labor agreements that protect the tenure, which to many has been something of a guaranteed job. Your thoughts?
I realized many years later that the very key thing we did pass back in 1991, even though the bill was terribly compromised, is that there was no mandate for collective bargaining and it would be separate from the district schools. Now, the unions can, the schools, charter schools can unionize themselves, of course. I'm very interested in this lawsuit because what I think will occur is it will put more pressure on the unions to come to the table and really do more about making sure that every teacher is living up to performance standards. And I think they haven't had reason to move in that direction, and I think this will do it. I also want to say this, though, and I'm very, very pleased about this. I'm a union-endorsed Democrat. Most people don't realize that. And so I really stay in touch with my union friends. And what's happening in Minnesota is this, that they, with the help of the American Federation of Teachers, initiated the first union-initiated charter school authorizer in this country. And now the very union leaders who opposed me 20 years ago in the state legislature are now on the board of the Minnesota Guild for Public Charter Schools, which is the first union-initiated charter school authorizer, and they're just going to open up their first authorized school this fall. Now,
really?
I'm pretty excited about that.
Will the teachers be tenured? And I presume they will.
I don't even know how the teachers, but here's the other thing that's happening, is that they see the opportunity to empower teachers and to allow teachers to lead the schools. So they are in a different role. They're not just teaching. It's not just tenure. It is about leading the school with a cooperative of teachers or leading the school with a professional partnership. That's what's coming out of this now. Teachers are seeing brand new opportunities here to use this autonomy in a different way. And that's part of what I like going around the country talking about, because then the unions maybe can think differently about this.
If you won the grand prize for the best self-published book, for 2013, I'm trying to imagine how many total self-published books that you beat out in 2013. I don't know if this is measured by anyone. Do you know? Do they say?
They told me there were 2,700 entries.
Wow.
So I'm very pleased about that. Yes, thank you.
All right.
I think the other thing about it, though, that does for me, it says it's more than reaching an education audience, because this is actually written as a personal memoir, and it's really about a story of many people, ordinary people like you and me, coming together and taking an extraordinary stand for change. And that's what charter school people do every single day. I'm now the chair of a board of a startup charter school, and I can tell you it is one of the hardest things we have ever done. So they're taking that stand for change. And that's what this is about, overcoming those barriers. Sometimes you do lose your friends in that, and how does that affect you? So it's a very personal memoir
sometimes.
As well. Yes,
people
yes.
sometimes yell at you and call you names.
But I hope that what this book does and this story does is to help everyone overcome the zero chance of passage in their life, because you have one and everyone has one, right? So that's more the bigger story, I think.
Ember Reichgott Junge, thanks for joining us on Choice Media. We appreciate it.
Thank you.